मैम, आर यू दीपा अग्रवाल और दीपा दीनदयाल मैम?
एक्चुअली आई एम नाउ आफ्टर मैरिज आई एम दीपा दीनदयाल, बट विद
ओके
प्रैक्टिस आई स्टिल मेंटेन अग्रवाल बिकॉज
ओके मैम,
लॉट ऑफ आर हैदराबादी क्राउड इज गेटिंग कंफ्यूज विद दीना दयाल, सो
ऑल
दैट्स
राइट,
व्हाई आई एम मेंटेनिंग माय
ओके ओके
पेरेंटल साइड अग्रवाल फॉर प्रैक्टिस पर्पस.
ओके मैम.
So, Lalita ma'am, session is all set.
Yes, sir.
I think you still have one more minute, though.
Yes, sir. Yes, another minute.
Yeah. Lalita ma'am, we can start the program. I just sent a text, ma'am, to you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes.
We can start the program, ma'am.
Yes. Okay, sir. Done. Good evening to all our wonderful audience of the webinar, Eat to Live, Lose Weight and Stay Fit. Let food be thy medicine. We have this wonderful webinar, which quite a few of us are eagerly waiting to be a part of. Well, I would like to begin the webinar by asking you all a question. Who is our life partner? Is it our mom, our dad, wife, husband, son, daughter, friends? Well, not at all. Our real life partner is our body. Once our body stops responding, nobody is with us. So our body and we stay together from birth till death. Okay, what we do to our body is our responsibility, and that comes back to us. The more we care for our body, the more fit the body will be. What we eat, what we do, how we deal with stress, how much of rest we give it, will decide how our body is going to respond. Remember that our body is the only permanent address where we live. Our body is our asset if we take good care of it. and becomes a liability if we do not. So our body is our responsibility. Money comes and goes. Friends and relatives are not permanent. Remember, no one will help us other than our body. To throw more light on this, we have two wonderful speakers. One is Dr. Deepa Agarwal Deendayal, who is a famous and best nutritionist and dietitian in Hyderabad and Secunderabad. Her diet clinic provides nutrition consultations for weight loss, to reduce the fat, even to gain weight, diet in pregnancy, lactation, pediatrics, diabetic diet, hypertension, cardiovascular and renal issues, bariatrics, cancer, sports nutrition, PCOD, PCOS. She specializes in individualized nutrition advice, and this is given to even, you know, new brides and grooms for good skin and hair. The other speaker is none other than our chairman, Mr. Rama Naidu, who is the founder chairman of Rockwoods International School. He started the first schools in 2005 with the intention of grooming students with the best education, with a deeper understanding and broad vision to scale his social enterprise and to improve quality in educational institutions. His experience with curriculum and his deep understanding of latest trends in education helps in achieving the organization's vision. We also have with us our CEO, Mr. Subramaniam, who's been trained in USA, UK, on various people management and operational efficiency matters. He has vast experience in Rankers and Akriti Group, and also as the CEO of Rockwoods International. He has been a consultant with MNCs for many, many years. His sharp insight into educational needs of students, nurturing integrated academic programs and technology assisted in realizing many children's dreams. We also have with us our education officer of Rankers and Akriti Group, Mr. R.K. Singh. And we'll begin this session with more insights on this from none other than our chairman, who is in fact an expert who will be giving us personal experience of his, you know, developing fitness and losing weight. Over to you, sir, chairman, sir, and then we will take Dr. Deepa.
Thank you, ma'am. Good evening to all of you. I would like to speak about a couple of minutes prior to our speaker. I would like to share my experience with this diet plan and also losing weight and becoming fit. On January 1st, 2020, I was 90 kgs. By April 28th, 2020, I reached around 70 kgs. I lost around 20 kgs in 4 months of duration. I would like to share my experience with diet. 4 months, how I try to maintain my diet and also how I change my day-to-day activities so that children and parents may learn few things and try to implement those things in day-to-day life that may help them to understand how diet is not about just controlling portion of intake or doing over exercise or excessive exercise to lose the weight. Diet is something like what you eat is more important than how much you eat, when you eat. So I'd like to share my screen and show you a few slides. So eat to live, lose weight. My children are very active and agile, and I would like to
incorrigible.
Yes. Thank you, children. You made me aware. Yeah. See, superior health is earned, not inherited. So many of us think based on our parents or our ancestors, because of their genes, we might have become little obese or overweight. But it's not true. Maybe it is true up to some extent, but mostly our weight and our fitness is related to the diet you eat, the kind of food you take, the kind of nutrients you take is more important. So as part of my diet plan for 4 months, even today, I'm continuing at the same weight, 70 kgs weight for the last 9 months. So usually any diet plans anyone follows, usually they regain the weight after a couple of months or a couple of years. I hope I may not going to gain the weight again as long as I continue the same diet plan. So as part of this, I never stop eating the food and also never try to restrict the intake of the food. The most important thing what I did is I started changing the kind of food I ate last 8 to 9 months. The first thing I changed is I stopped eating all carbohydrates and high fat foods, especially the white rice and with all the junk foods, which are high in carbohydrates and low in nutrients or vitamins or any other fibers. The second important thing I changed in my life is I started taking warm water from morning 5 o'clock to night 9:30. At least every day I used to drink, I am drinking even now, 5 to 6 liters of water. Because of this water and also diet change, and I have been practicing other meditation practices so that I try to stay focused on myself and also not feel emotionally hungry and eat overeat. So mostly I used to do lots of eatings because of my stress or over busyness. And I used to meet many people in my office. The only way to engage the people are we are used to offer tea or coffee or snack. So as part of Indian culture, I used to practice these things prior to January. I used to eat at least 7 to 8 times a day at 6 to 8 cups of coffee. These things itself used to be contributing around 1000 to 1200 calories other than my 3 to 4 meals. So that means every day I used to take around 3 to 4,000 calories of food, whereas my exercise or my work used to be not more than 1500 calories. That means as a human being, I used to eat more than 1500 calories every day. That made me to become obese and also have a lot of other health problems. So what I practice, I would like to show with you what is for my diet. The first of all, I started eating mindful eating along with my children. So mindful eating is nothing but we used to switch off our TV and all of us sit together, start discussing about the food, what we are eating and its taste, and thinking about food and eating is had become a practice in our family. And that helped us to eat whatever we want, at the same time try to control unwanted food eating. The second thing, we stopped eating all the whites, which is white rice, white sugar, white salt, and milk. In fact, I try to convert myself as a vegan, where even many of the animal products also I stopped taking it. And every meal, I made sure that at least 2 to 3 vegetable salads used to eat and 2 to 3 fruits. And every meal, other than these two, we used to take plenty of salads. That helped us to eat nutrients, minerals, vitamins, rather than eating more carbohydrates or fat. In the mealtime, mostly either I take oats or millets or jowar roti. That helped me to take whole grain foods that used to give me my energy with lots of nutrients and vitamins and helped us to fill our stomach so easily so that we don't eat too much of calories. Other than this, whenever we feel like eating, I used to take either nuts or seeds rather than any snacks or cookies or French fries, all those things. Even I made my children who is studying grade 5 and grade 1 and grade 2, they started getting habituated eating either nuts or seeds or sprouts as part of their snack. So otherwise, previously, children used to take a lot of candy bars or chocolate or cookies, or they used to ask lots of fried items. Since children are habituated for those kinds of junk foods, we always show our love. We always show our love to our children by providing the food. Instead of spending quality amount of time with them, we always wanted to express our love, our kindness, or whatever compassion towards them giving the food. So that made them too much fat. My daughter, who was grade 4 last year, she was almost 56 kgs after following this diet, mindfulness eating, mindfulness diet. She reached around 45 kgs within 3 months. Now she is very much happy and really agile. And also I started practicing mindful walking in the morning and evening so that I burn few amounts of fat, calories, whatever I eat every day. So this is all about diet I used to follow for the last 3 months. And in addition to this diet, I also followed intermittent fasting in my schedule. So what exactly intermittent fasting I try to follow is 8 hours of eating window we kept. Morning 9 o'clock to evening 5 o'clock is the only eating window for entire family members. And evening 5 o'clock to next day morning, it's all fasting window. If really feel like eating something, then we either used to take lemon water or green tea, or just you take 1 or 2 teaspoons of honey. So intermittent fasting helped me a lot, not only controlling my weight, and also it helped me to really focus constantly on my work. Otherwise, previously I used to eat whenever we feel stressed, whenever we feel really get bored with our work, we used to take some snack and eat a lot of things. That used to waste a lot of time and also a lot of distractions. So that's how intermittent fasting helped me to lose the weight and become more efficient and effective. When it comes to my schedule usually starts the day around morning 5 a.m. After waking up, after brushing my teeth, I drink 1 liter of warm water. Then I'll go for a walk around 30 minutes, 3 to 3.5 kilometers of walk, and I'll do exercise or yoga around 15-20 minutes along with my children, and also do practice meditation for 15-20 minutes. I practice Vipassana meditation. All these things I do along with my children. So because of that, I get social acceptance, and also I feel like part of the family. And I always feel like comparing ourselves, how much weight we lost, how much food we are eating, how much time we did exercise, how many seconds we are doing each asanas. So that social acceptance made me to really think that it is a part of life. I never feel like it is like I'm trying to do some exercise for losing the weight. Or I just made this schedule for the last 9 months is part of life. Hence, so I never feel like I'm trying to do some diet program, I'm losing weight. And also, so that feeling never had come to my mind. Then at 9 a.m. we breakfast, 1 p.m. lunch, and 5 p.m. dinner, and 6 p.m. again, we go for second wind workout, that is evening walk, or mostly either do brisk walk or running. So after evening, again, I'll spend little amount of time for my office work or just reading some good books or watching some nice videos or blinks. So intermittent fasting helped me to gain lots of strength. And also, we as human beings learn in our life either to have feast or starvation of the food. Our ancestors, thousands of years back, whenever they get some nice animal for part of their hunting, they used to have feast. If they don't get food, they used to be fasting for 2-3 days. So body is structured either for fasting or feasting, not for eating every 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours. So maybe I also got habituated eat whenever you eat sufficient food, enough number of amount of food, so that your stomach becomes full, and next 4 hours you can concentrate on your work or concentrate on reading or concentrate on any other work. And next 16 hours, your body and your digestive systems will get sufficient amount of rest, so that it concentrates more on metabolism and also give you enough energy to focus. And also your brain will be little active. And you also might have seen, fasting is part of a culture. When Ramzan comes, most of the people also do intermittent fasting. They eat early in the morning and they don't eat till late in the evening. That is one part of intermittent fasting. That means they are not eating almost 16 to 18 hours. Our Christians also do the same thing. I think they do in the month of April, some Lent or something. I'm not really clear. And Hindus do the fasting as part of their Saturdays or Mondays or Tuesdays. So for these things, part of our culture, because that's how our ancestors felt that if you wanted to have a good health, a human being should get acquainted with some kind of fasting so that body will get enough rest and they can control their diseases. Eating also should have lots of nutrients that only will happen with plant-based food. That's what I learned. So that's the reason every day I made sure that I eat one or two vegetable salads with green vegetables and fruits. And I also prefer to eat fruits which are not having high fructose. Mostly I try to eat citrus fruits, either kiwis or oranges or dragon fruits. So these kind of fruits. So believe me, when I was in the Jan first, my weight was 90 and my sugars were almost around 180 or 200. Now, last 6 months, I'm not using even diabetic tablets. Still, my sugars are under control. My fasting sugar is almost 80 or 90. My post-lunch, it never crossed around 120. So that means intermittent fasting and your diet made you to get rid of your type 2 diabetes also. So whatever the disorders, whether it's a diabetes disorder, or the heart problems, or the cancer issues, are just because of the diet and food you take, not because of your parents or your ancestors. So what you eat is what you are. And your efficiency and your mindfulness, your focus towards work, your temper control, everything would be in control when you eat the food which has lots of nutrients, which has vitamins and fibers and phytochemicals. These things only will happen when you eat plant-based foods rather than depending on the foods or animal products or any other processed carbohydrates like pasta or wheat, which is processed in the white in color. So this is what I practice. I'm happy. I hope many of the students and parents also can start practicing. If they have any doubt or any question, they can ask me at the end of the session, or I'm always available to all of you. You can talk to me anytime. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chairman Sir. I think it was very enlightening. This is really very valuable because it's a personal experience, which, it's not told out of, just reading something or a theoretical knowledge, but it's practical knowledge experienced by a person. Thank you very much, sir. Now we have a small poll which Subi sir has given, post which we will have our main resource person for today, Dr. Deepa Agarwal Deen Dayal, who will be speaking on the same.
Yes, ma'am.
Shall we start?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
So that was a very exciting journey, sir. And I really congratulate you, because 20 kgs weight loss in 4 months of time is really, really appreciable. And I think you've done it in the most appropriate manner by counting your nutrients and following your time schedule with exercise, keeping your stress at, you know, towards the lower side. I think I really congratulate you, sir. So that's exactly what we practice when people come and meet us. Exactly, this is exactly what we teach them. And it's not about crash dieting. It's not about taking supplements. It's not about taking any medicines for weight loss. What we do as nutritionists is teach the right art of eating. So once we teach we don't call them patients, we call them clients. So when we have clients visiting us, we teach them the right art of eating, and that's how they are successful. And that's how they are able to maintain themselves in long run, because time and again, they did not see a nutritionist, you know, to keep their health at check. Once they learn the art, they are masters of it and they're able to follow it long term. I think that's how the success is. So let's understand more on this topic of nutrition. And I've been given this topic of how to eat to live, lose weight and stay fit. So I'll just enlarge this screen. I hope it is on a larger scale now.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Right. So obesity, as we all know, is a serious epidemic. Earlier, it was a cosmetic problem, but no more it's a cosmetic problem. As per WHO in 2004, they have claimed this to be a medical disease. Now, why medical disease? Because it's a precursor for a lot of diseases what we generally see these days. And I'll be talking to you about that in my next slides. As sir has mentioned, food for all of us is an addiction. As sir was mentioning that earlier when in school or in office, when there was some get together, tea and biscuits, tea and coffee used to be a way of, you know, entertaining people or way of celebration. And I think that's how it's at any level. Now, for all of us, food is an addiction. We eat when we are hungry. We eat when we are not hungry. We eat because, you know, when we are happy, we eat. We eat when we are sad. When we are stressed out, we eat. When we are among people in crowd, we eat. When food is good at home, mom is, you know, prepared very nice food at home, we tend to eat. When we are in a company, when we don't want to displease somebody, we try to eat. So in occasions like childbirth, marriages, you know, when you have career promotions, when your targets are being achieved, all of us try to celebrate by way of eating, by throwing parties. Now, what happens when you tend to eat? So ideally, what happens is when you tend to take extra calories than what is required by your body, starts accumulating these calories, and over time, it gets stored in your body and you tend to put on weight. Now, as per research, it is said that if you take even 100 calories extra per day, that will account to at least putting on 5 kgs weight in a year's time. And this is as simple as taking a cup of tea with 1 teaspoon of sugar and 1 Marie Light biscuit extra per day. So if you keep this habit of having extra calories every day, then certainly you put on a lot of weight in a year's time. And this itself can lead to overweight status and obesity status. Now, what happens is once a person starts putting on weight, if a person has like up to 10 kgs body weight extra, person is under overweight category. But if it is more than 10 kgs, then he lands up in obesity, wherein he can be in grade 1, grade 2, grade 3 obesity or super obesity status. Now, obesity is definitely not a good situation because it is a precursor for various diseases. It can call you for diabetes. As mentioned, type 2 diabetes is very common in people who have obesity. It can call you for hypertension, that is also called as blood pressure. Hyperlipidemia, wherein the cholesterol, the total triglycerides, the LDL levels increase and the HDL levels decrease. It can also lead to osteoarthritis, especially in elderly people who are above 50 or 60. It calls for a lot of arthritic changes, wherein there's knee pain, joint pains, and so on and so forth. Not only that, it can also lead to different type of cancer, especially in women above 50. We've seen that a lot of endometrial cancer happens because of obesity, because of the hormonal changes that happens because of obesity. Now, some of the other common problems that we see is fatty liver. Now, somebody who has obesity and with increased triglyceride, increased cholesterol, they tend to get, you know, either gallbladder stones or they tend to get fatty liver. which is not a good sign. It can also lead to a lot of changes in the skin. Many people have this eczema kind of a skin because of, you know, weight, when especially in the, you know, in the thigh regions and all, because of excessive fat, they tend to have a lot of skin changes. People also have sleep apnea, snoring concerns, wherein there's a lot of fat accumulation in the neck region, and because of which they cannot breathe in and breathe out completely at night, and that's how they get snoring concerns. Many women face lower back pain, especially when they have a lot of abdominal fat. So it's again a reason because of weight. Many young girls, especially in the age group of, you know, 18 and above till 30, 35, a lot of women come to us with PCOD problem, also called as polycystic ovarian disease. It's a hormonal imbalance. It could be because of weight. It could be because of stress. So again, it leads to infertility. So PCOD women tend to get infertile, and that's how, you know, a lot of, you know, complications arises, menstrual disturbances, they have, you know, skin changes and hirsutism. So these are all related to obesity concerns. And most of them get into depression, and they have all the psychosomatic conditions. So, you know, losing weight in them definitely helps. We also see people coming to us with hiatus hernia, wherein if they have a lot of fat on the abdomen, the muscles of the, you know, the abdomen become weak, and there's hernia formation. And it's sometimes either umbilical hernia or hiatus hernia commonly seen. So again, it's a reason, obesity is a reason for it. Many of them are prone to accidents, because when somebody is very obese and they don't see the path completely, when they are walking, they tumble and fall. So that's how they are prone to accidents. So these are some of the risk factors associated with obesity. The main other health factors like diabetes, hypertension, hormonal imbalances, wherein thyroid and PCOS occurs, osteoarthritis, cancer, and the others are the secondary factors. Now, we as healthcare professionals, we definitely want these to be, brought down in people who come to us with these concerns, and changing their lifestyle do help in most of them. Now, earlier, obesity was, as I told you, it was only a cosmetic problem. It was not a medical disease. But nowadays, it's a medical disease, and we've been seeing a lot of deaths because of obesity. A lot of people die because of coronary artery disease, cancer concerns and all. So our aim is to stop obesity and help people who are obese. As per latest figures, we see almost 20% of our Hyderabadi population have something called as diabesity. Diabesity is a new term used for people who have both obesity and diabetes. So we are the leading capital of our country. So it's very important that at least we, Hyderabadi population, take care of our obesity and make sure that we don't get diabetes, hypertension, hormonal changes, and cholesterol concerns and all early in life. Also, as per research, it is indicated that if you lose even 1 kg body weight, you will increase your life expectancy by at least 3 to 4 months. So it's very, very important that if somebody is overweight or obese, please cut down weight so that your quality of life improves and you are very, very healthy. Now, this is something which we commonly see or hear from clients who come to us when they come to meet us. Ma'am, I don't eat anything. I eat only salads. I eat only fruits, but still I'm obese. Why? Because there are errors. There are errors either in your type of food that you eat, the quality that you eat, or the portion size that you eat, or the timings at which you eat, or your activities, your stress levels, your sleeping pattern. Everything has an impact on your body weight. Now, this figure says us how our lifestyle has become. Like before Corona, most of us had this lifestyle, though, you know, Corona has actually, you know, brought down our lifestyle a bit. It has, you know, made us, you know, wait and understand ourselves. So I think before Corona, most of us had this lifestyle wherein everybody, you know, they have the targets to be achieved. So they either wake up late, start the day with a tea or a coffee, have no breakfast or absolutely very little breakfast or unhealthy breakfast, quickly have some lunch at the cafeteria, then have a very heavy snack at the, you know, while leaving from office, go back home, have a heavy dinner, and then go to bed without any exercise. So once this kind of a lifestyle is adopted for years together, definitely your body starts rejecting and your body starts changing its metabolism and you tend to put on weight. Now, that's how when your energy expenditure comes down and your body's metabolism slows down, because of which you tend to put on weight. So it's not about, you know, just eating salads or fruits to maintain weight. It's about a wholesome diet. It's about, you know, having a balance of all the four factors, that is diet, exercise, stress, and sleep. And that's how you can maintain your weight. So as nutritionists, when somebody comes to us, what do? We teach them the right art of eating. It's not about dieting. So this word dieting is something which I feel is not appropriately understood by many of us. It's about eating healthy. It's about how you balance your food, you know, compose your diet in such a way that it gives you all the nutrients and keeps you disease free. So for doing this, what we promote is to follow a balanced diet. Now, most of the patients or clients who do weight loss because of frustration or whatever you call it, they ideally go on to a very low calorie diet. Low calorie diet, very, you know, even 700 to 800 calories is, you know, what they try to achieve. Initially, they tend to lose weight because all the water weight, what is there in the body because of excessive carbohydrates or whatever it is, tends to come out. But eventually, after a certain period of time, like we've seen up for 4 to 6 weeks, they plateau down. They see no further weight loss because there's no balance in the nutrients. They are onto a crash diet. By virtue of which, what happens is such people, they land up with frustration. Frustration because they are trying hard and they're not losing weight. So after a certain point of time, they feel like discontinuing the diet. Once they discontinue the diet, what happens is they tend to gain all the weight what they have lost. And this time they gain even more and become into the same weight, they land up into the same weight status which they were earlier. So this kind of a yo-yo phenomenon is very commonly seen in younger populations, especially in college going students or youngsters who are trying to achieve weight loss in a faster mode. So these things needs to be taken care of. Such crash dieting should be avoided because in the long run, definitely it has an impact on the body wherein you land up with nutritional deficiencies and your body's metabolism slows down. So no crash dieting, go on to a diet which is more balanced, more natural, and all home food, nothing processed, and which you can practice over a period of time. And as nutritionists, this is what we teach you. This is something again, to understand that if you want to lose at least 0.5 kg per week, then you should be burning at least 3,500 calories extra every week. So if you do that, you will be able to lose at least 0.5 kg per week. And that's as per the guidelines. This is as per our Asia Pacific guidelines that if you lose 0.5 kg, some people even lose up to 1 kg per week. It is well within the range and you will not land up with complications. Why again, aggressive dieting or aggressive weight loss is not recommended? Because aggressive weight loss can cause certain concerns like gallbladder stone formation. Some people, you know, eventually land up with a lot of deficiencies. So to make sure that you don't have such concerns, we go very slow and steady and, you know, teach you the art of eating. So while we are doing this, first thing we talk to our clients is about a balanced food pyramid. Now at the base of the pyramid, as you see, it's written as 8 to 10 glasses of water per day. As sir was also mentioning that fluids are very important. Fluid is a macronutrient. Water is a macronutrient and it is one of the most essential nutrient required by a body because it helps in, you know, improving your metabolism. Every organ, be it be liver, be it be kidney, your heart, your brain, every organ requires water for its functioning. So if you are not well hydrated throughout the day, obviously these organs are taxed and your metabolism slows down. So make sure you drink enough fluids throughout the day. Minimum is 8 to 10 glasses. If you have a larger surface area, that means if you're more taller and, you know, you have a better, height, then make sure that you drink more water so that it takes care of your losses that you're having throughout the day as well. Next, we talk about in the group is fruits and vegetables. Why fruits and vegetables? Because fruits and vegetables gives you a lot of fiber, especially soluble fiber. And it is a powerhouse of micronutrients. Lot of vitamins, lot of minerals comes from fruits and vegetables. Now, when we talk to students especially, to make them understand, we tell them, have a diet which has rainbow color fruits and vegetables every day. Because every color of fruit and vegetable has a particular phytonutrient which is very, very important for your body. Every, you know, fruit, every vegetable has a property which is beneficial to your body. There's no fruit, no vegetable which will be harmful to your body unless you have a medical condition. For example, if you are diabetic or if you have any hormonal concern like thyroid, or if you have any other, you know, concerns like psoriasis and all, there are certain restrictions which we gave as a list. But otherwise, as a normal individual, if you don't have a medical condition, you can eat whatever is available locally, seasonally, and as per your budget. It's not necessary you have to buy very high-fi fruits, you know, high expensive fruits and vegetables to keep yourself healthy. Because many of the clients, again, have a feeling that when it is something expensive, it will be beneficial to our body. It's not so. Even as guava, which is, you know, a moderately priced vegetable, is beneficial to your body. Likewise, something like a, you know, bottle gourd or a rich gourd, which is also moderately priced, is beneficial to your body. So make sure that you take whatever is available locally, seasonally, as per your budget, and make sure you take at least 2 fruits, 3 variety of vegetables in your diet regularly. So this is bare minimum that you have to include. Next, we talk about is cereals and pulses. Cereals and pulses is important because they give you carbohydrates, that is the calories especially coming from carbohydrates, and pulses give you enough of proteins. So when you take them in combination, they complement for each other's deficiencies, and I mean the, you know, the areas in which they lack, and that's how they are able to help us. So make sure you take 2 to 3 servings of cereals and pulses in your diet regularly so that you'll get enough carbohydrates and enough protein in your diet. We also talk about milk and milk products and non-veg. Now, if you're a vegan or if you're, you know, a person who cannot tolerate milk and milk products, you can avoid them. You can go for alternative sources like almond milk, soy milk, corn milk, rice milk, which is also available these days. And if you're a non-vegetarian who do not eat non-veg, you can look for other high-protein sources in vegetarians like paneer, soya, tofu, because all of them give equal amount of proteins like non-veg. So if you are a vegan or a complete vegetarian, you can look for such options, but make sure you take 2-3 servings of these in your diet regularly. Avoid taking red meat because red meat causes inflammation in the body. And it, in the long run, a lot of people get a lot of colon concerns. So it should be avoided regularly. Maybe once in 1 month or 2 months once, it is okay. But in the daily consumption, it should be avoided. The last group, what you see on the pyramid, is about fats and oil and sugar-containing food options. Now, of course, sugar-containing food options should be completely avoided because it does no benefit to your body. It only gives you simple sugars, simple carbohydrate, and it unnecessarily gets stored in your body. Look for alternative sources like palm jaggery, honey, maple syrup, coconut sugar, because these are more beneficial options than white sugar. Likewise, oil should not be completely avoided in the diet because many of them have a, you know, mindset, if I take oil, I'll become fat. See, there is a proportion in which you have to use it in your diet. 3 teaspoons of oil per day is what we recommend to any individual who comes to us. So 15 ml of oil, cooking oil, can be used. Now you can use rice bran oil, sunflower oil, gingerly oil, sesame oil, cooking olive oil. So these are some of the oils which you can use for consumption regularly. Based on the number of members, you can calculate the total portion of oil. And actually, you know, you can portion your oil in such a way that it is equally divided for breakfast, lunch and dinner. Likewise, ghee. If you don't like oil, you can still take 1 tablespoon of ghee every day because ghee gives you a lot of antioxidants. And it is also cardioprotective. It is good for your joints. So definitely it is advisable. Don't completely avoid fats and oil or ghee from your diet. Why? Another one important reason is because they help in absorption of fat-soluble vitamins in your body, especially vitamin A, vitamin D, vitamin E, vitamin K. These vitamins are only absorbed in your body if you have sufficient oil and fat or ghee coming from your diet. So that's why you should take them in the right proportion, but don't over exceed. Don't take more than 15 or 20 ml in the total day. So while we are talking to about how to learn art of eating by following a balanced pyramid, the next topic we discuss is about the meal timings. Now, not all of us have the habit of following a schedule regularly. So there's a haphazard way of doing things. Now, when the meal timings are not appropriate, especially your breakfast time and your dinner time, obviously your body's biological rhythm changes and it starts showing up. Like you might see that you might have gastritis concerns, you might have acidity concerns, you have constipation issues, not digesting food properly. So these happens when you don't follow appropriate meal timings in most of the cases. So ideally breakfast, lunch and dinner. These are three major meals which you should follow. In between, you can have a mid-morning option or tea time option. If you are in the in a category wherein you are trying to maintain your weight and trying to become healthy. Obviously, there are other concepts of intermittent fasting and all. If somebody is following that, then you know we need to cut down on the frequency, and we need to balance the diet in such a way that within that same time schedule, you are able to eat what is recommended. So if you have a habit of getting up late, then your breakfast should be at least ideally 2 hours after you wake up. So breakfast, if you have woke up by around 6, 6:30, you can have your breakfast by 9, 8:39. And breakfast should be a traditional way of eating, wherein whatever has been made at home, like your regular idli or upma or dosa or, you know, pesara, these kind of things is what we eat. But yes, of course, if you have a challenge wherein you are trying to lose weight, then you can replace these breakfast options by more of millet options. Like you can have ragi dosa, you can have oats dosa, you can have millet upma, you can have pesara, you can have chenaga pindi dosa. So these are something which will help you in losing weight, you know, and balancing your nutrients simultaneously. But avoid anything which is processed bakery items, like, you know, your croissants, your bread, muffins, because especially children, they try to grab all these things and come to school. So ideally, this is not recommended. And especially children, most of them, they tend to, you know, miss their breakfast also. So if you have a habit of missing breakfast, please have breakfast regularly, because breakfast is the most important meal of your day. It gives you enough fuel so that you can, you know, study throughout your day properly. You can concentrate and, you know, you are able to fare better at home as well as in school. Next important meal is your lunch meal. Lunch meal obviously has to be a proper meal wherein it comprises of all the 5 food groups, your cereal, pulses, fruits, vegetables, and your milk and meat products. Have a proportion of each, more of protein, moderate carbs, and less fat, and complete it between 1, 1:30 if you had your breakfast between 8:39. Ideally, the gastric emptying time, that is the time which is taken for the food to travel from the stomach to the intestine, is 2.5 to 3 hours. So if you have a mid-morning snack, then it will prevent you from getting any gas issues, acidity issues, and all. So if you want between breakfast and lunch, you can have a mid-morning option, like you can grab a small fruit, or you can have a small cup of buttermilk, or you can have some nimbu pani, some jaljeera, some coconut water, whatever you can, you know, carry to your school or to your office is something which you can have at mid-morning. Then in the evening, you know, say around 6, 6:30, 7 is what you should have your dinner. Dinner should be the lightest meal of your day, and it should comprise of more of proteins and less of simple carbs. So you can again repeat one of your breakfast options, whatever you eat in the morning, or have, if you are good at having soups and salads, you can do that. Make sure that you are not sleeping on an empty stomach, because then, you know, your sleep will be disturbed and you'll not be able to fare well the next day. If you have a habit of eating a late dinner, then make sure your sleep time is equally spaced. So you can, you know, make sure that there's a gap of at least 3, 3.5 hours before you go to bed. So if you are able to follow these meal timings with appropriate, you know, intervals, then your body responds very well. You'll not accumulate weight, and you'll be energetic, and you'll not have any concerns related to your GI. So while you are doing that, make sure your balance of nutrients is being met, and you are able to follow your timings as well. Include some superfoods in your diet. There's no big funder with this term called superfoods. Superfoods are nothing but foods what we eat regularly at home. Even your banana is a superfood. Your nuts that you eat is a superfood. The millets that you eat is a superfood. It's just a way of, you know, attracting people when, you know, marketing gimmicks wherein, you know, lot of things are being sold with the word superfood, natural, organic, and so on and so forth. So make sure that whatever you buy, you read the labels carefully and then include them in your consumption. So what are superfoods? They are nothing but any food which gives you a lot of antioxidants, they are immunonutrients and anti-aging. They are superfoods. So I thought I'll just list out a few so that you know what is superfood. And you know, you should not get carried away by different marketing products, what is happening in the, you know, supermarkets and all these days. So you should know whatever you're eating is definitely a superfood. Now, chia seeds, what we see is a superfood. This seed is also called a sabza seed. You soak them, put it in your buttermilk, or you can put it in your shakes and have. And it is a powerhouse of calcium, phosphorus, dietary fiber, and manganese. So if you take like 1 teaspoon of chia seeds every day in your diet, then it keeps you full and it also helps you in weight loss. Next, we talk about is flax seeds. In Telugu, you call it as Avasi Genjilu. So Avasi Genjilu is actually a power pack seed of omega-3 fatty acids and omega-6. So somebody who is a pure vegetarian, not eating fish, can take flax seeds up to 2 teaspoons per day. That is around 10 grams per day, so that you get enough omega-3 and 6. And that also helps you in improving your cholesterol levels, keeping your joints, you know, nourished. And you don't tend to get back pain, knee pain, and all that. So make sure you take 2 teaspoons of flax seeds every day in your diet. It can be in a powder form or it can be in the actual seed form, whichever way you want. Next, we talk about is quinoa or different kind of millets. Nowadays, there's a lot of millets available in the market. So different kind of millets like korulu, also called as foxtail millet, sajulu, small millet, proso millet, quinoa. So all these millets are nothing but a power pack house of different kind of micronutrients, especially B6, B3, thiamine, riboflavin, vitamin E, phosphorus, calcium, and a lot of soluble fiber. And some of these millets, like quinoa, is a gluten-free millet. So if you have a concern wherein you are having any intestinal problems like irritation in your irritable bowel syndrome or celiac disease or Crohn's disease or ulcerative colitis, then quinoa is something which is advisable. And this is very good. It can be replaced with your rice or wheat. You can cook it, have it like with rice, with your, you know, dal, vegetables and curd. It can be ate at lunchtime or at dinner time, whenever you want. Many people are doing a lot of innovative recipes, like they make dosas out of it and have, or they make pulao out of it and have. So it can be used in any way that you want. Next, we talk about is green tea. Now, green tea is again a superfood because it has a lot of phytonutrients. Don't use a lot of green tea bags. Try to use the fresh leaves or the, you know, packed leaves that you get in the market these days. You can add little cinnamon powder, honey, lemon juice, dry ginger, and cumin seeds powder to make it more effective. So if you're trying to take 1 or 2 cups of green tea in place of your regular tea, coffee, definitely it helps you in cutting down your weight and also gives you a lot of phytonutrients. Already spoke about foxtail millet, that is korulu. So you can use them in place of your rice, that is white rice, or you can replace your wheat, which is full of gluten, with millets, so that you lose weight also, fill yourself with enough, you know, fill your stomach properly and, you know, get enough nutrients as well. So you can convert it into a dosa or idli or upma, or just cook it like rice and have it with your other options. Spirulina is again a very important it's an important superfood because it gives you a lot of protein, especially for vegetarians. If you are, you know, not getting enough proteins from the sources that you're eating for various reasons, then you can add spirulina in your diet. Now, spirulina is nothing but a blue-green algae, and it is available in powder form. You can add it to your shake, to your buttermilk, to your sambar, in whichever liquid you want, and have it at least 1 teaspoon per day. That will give you enough proteins. Probiotics are also superfoods because they have good bacteria. So when you take probiotic curd or yogurt, once it enters your system, it helps you improving your gut microflora, especially your E. coli bacteria improves when you take a probiotic. So if you have GI concerns of like dyspepsia, when you keep belching, or you have gastritis, acidity, then you can take a probiotic curd or a yogurt at lunchtime and at dinner time so that your gut improves and you become more healthy. Berries are also very good source of, it's a power pack of phytonutrients and it's a superfood, especially in this season. We're getting a lot of berries, especially, you know, you're getting strawberries, mulberries. So you can use them as a snacking option rather than grabbing some processed foods like chips and biscuits and namkeens, which are unhealthy. So try to include them in your diet, some of these superfoods, while balancing your nutrients and following your meal times. And make sure that you portion your food in the correct manner. Don't increase the portion size. Use proper cups, measuring, glasses, serving holders, plates, spoons, and eat as per your requirement. Don't overdo on your sizes also, because if you overdo on the portion size, then definitely you are increasing your nutrient count of calories or whatever it is, and you will tend to put on weight. So don't upsize your intake by increasing your portions, using bigger serving items. Use as what is required by you, for you. So you don't have to eat less, you just have to eat right. And while you are doing this, you have mindful eating habits. What are mindful eating habits? Especially in children, don't eat while you're watching television. Keep your television, keep your iPad, laptop away from your dining table. Make sure you portion your food, get your food on table, eat with the family, and eat in the right proportion. If you have a concern wherein you feel you're either under eating or overeating, keep a analysis, keep a record for what you eat. This will help you in your self-analysis. So when you write down in a book what all you ate in a week's time, and then you go back and see after a week, which were the core areas where you went wrong, under what conditions you ate the junk food, under what condition you didn't eat, why, what was the reason. All these areas can be identified and it can be worked upon. So you can do a SWOT analysis for yourself and improve your eating habits as well. Third is, read the nutritional labels of foods, especially the food packets that you get from the supermarkets, even a rice packet, a dal packet, or any oil, whatever you buy from the market, please read the nutrient labels, because this will increase your knowledge. It will tell you how many calories it is giving, what nutrient is more in that food product. Like, for example, you buy olive oil. Olive oil is a source of omega 3 and 6. So as students, you'll get to know, okay, fine, olive oil has this much of PUFA, this much of MUFA, how much of total saturated fat it is. So that increases your knowledge, and it will also help you count what you eat. So try to change some of your eating habits and develop some mindful eating habits, because this will also help you. Now, all of us have to attend parties. We tend to go out, we socialize with friends, family, and we tend to eat out, because obviously food is a way of celebration. So when you're eating out, make sure you choose food wisely. Now, if instead of eating a pasta which is of maida, you can look in the menu book, you can look for options which are more of like millet based or whole wheat pasta or durum pasta, so that you can improve the quality of food when you eat out. So every menu card will have both healthy and unhealthy option. It is the mind that you have to tune yourself. So if you tune yourself for healthier options, definitely you can choose the correct ones and still enjoy your food when you eat out, and you'll not put on weight. Now, as I have already told you, do not upsize your options. Try to keep it low, especially when you eat out, and even at home, don't increase your portion size and eat. Now, sodium content in your food is also important, because it plays an important role in maintaining your body's blood pressure and water homeostasis in your body. If you eat a lot of processed foods, especially chips, all these cookies, macaroons, biscuits, bread, all these things have a lot of sodium, and excessive sodium intake will retain water in your body. Make sure that you cut down on excessive processed foods, absolutely no processed foods, and even your salt intake should not be more than 5 grams per day. 5 grams is nothing but 1 teaspoon of salt, iodized salt per day. Again, there's a lot of myth. Some people say, can I have rock salt? Some say, can I have uniodized salt? I would say have iodized salt, because iodine coming from salt is very, very important for the neurological functioning of your body. And that's why salt has been, fortified, or, it was one item which was, iodine was fortified for. So it is very important that you take iodized salt. Other salts can be used for other purposes, like in your raita or as topping on your salads and all, but not for regular consumptions. Go for iodized salt. If somebody has blood pressure at home, cut down on the sodium intake, cut down to salt intake to around 2 to 3 grams per day, and try to maintain that. And as you age, as you're growing, make sure you're active, join different classes like games classes. You can join swimming, cycling, and various activities based on what age group you're in. And make sure you cut down on your stress and, make sure you have good sleep. So when you keep all your 4 factors under control, you will have a very good healthy lifestyle and a sound body, and you'll be able to keep yourself away from diseases. So as my last slide, I would say, take charge of your health today. Your body is, you know, it's like a vehicle. If you give it right nutrients, it will take you to different good places. So thank you all. If you have any questions, please ask me.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank well you, ma'am. Very, very well said.
Well said. Very well said.
And ma'am, we have lots of questions, and I hand it over to Subramaniam sir to moderate the QA session. However, we are actually short of time, but I think, sir, you can club some questions and then, you know, put them together, sir.
Sure, ma'am.
Definitely. Over to you.
Yes. So, ma'am, first question that we have for today is, especially, you know, to fight against corona, or, you know, if I'm a corona patient, what kind of food that we should take?
So during this phase of corona pandemic, obviously all of us should eat from home. That's the first important thing. No eating food from outside, because still, you know, I am hearing from a lot of parents and youngsters who are visiting our clinic saying, you know, abhi bhi parcel aata hai, takeaways ho ja rahe hain, all that should be stopped. Eat what is cooked at home, freshly prepared, and of course in a balanced manner, all what we spoke now, and include more of like immunonutrient foods, like you can add flax seeds, chia seeds, which gives you more of omega 3 and 6. Have more of citric fruits, which gives you a lot of antioxidants, because they are rich source of vitamin C, like moussambi, orange, pineapple, grapes, lot of berries, and a balanced diet. So if you eat a balanced diet, what happens is you get enough nutrients for the infections to be fought against also. Cut down on, you know, non-vegetarian sources like chicken, fish, because after all, they are from the animal product. You can still have egg whites, but if you can substitute egg whites also with other protein sources like, you know, nuts and good pulses or sprouts at home, that would be also advisable. So I think a balance of all nutrients with more of immunonutrients, more of antioxidants is something which is advisable.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. The second question, I think many of students are asking, you know, if I need to grow height, if I need to be taller, what kind of food, you know, the children should be taking?
Again, so it depends on what age group they are on, because if every age group, especially in pediatrics, different age group have a different protein requirements and a different calorie requirement. So based on what age group you are in, you should make sure you take enough proteins and calories, because that will help you in your growth spurt, and it will help you in your tissue and bone development. That's how, you know, you'll be able to increase your height, especially in girls. After puberty till 18 years of age, the height of a girl grows. And in men, especially in boys, after puberty, it grows up till 20-21 years of age. So during this phase, especially in the post-pubertal age group, that is after 12 and 13 in girls and in boys after 14, you make sure that you take enough of proteins, enough of calories, so that you are able to attain your maximum height during this phase.
Okay, great, ma'am. And the next question that we have is, you know, one of the participant is asking, we don't take fish. So what would be the, you know, right substitute for that?
Yeah, so fish is ideally taken for its protein content and for its omega 3 and 6 content. So for proteins, which comes from fish, you can take the vegetarian sources, like you can take different type of pulses like dals. You can have different type of lentils or legumes like chane, chole, rajma, lobia. You can have soya meal maker. You can have nuts. You can have other protein sources or milk and milk products, like you can have curd, paneer, cheese. So all these things, if you take, it also gives you enough protein like fish.
Maybe sprouts be one of the...
Sprouts is again a very good source of protein.
Very good source of protein.
Yes. And for omega 3, you can have flax seeds or chia seeds in your diet every day. Even if you take like 2 teaspoons of flax seeds every day, it's more than sufficient.
Okay. And I think one last question, given the time limit that we have, many participants are asking, how can I get, vitamin D?
Vitamin D is a sunshine vitamin. So mostly it is attained, you know, it is when you sit under sunlight, when you're exposed to sunlight, once the sunlight falls on our skin, the activation, the precursors of vitamin D starts getting formed, and then it is processed through the liver and kidneys, and it is available to your body. But if you are not exposed to sunlight every day, very minimal amount of vitamin D comes from food, especially milk and milk products and green leafy vegetables. So make sure that you are exposed to sunlight every day, 20-25 minutes every day, so that enough of vitamin D is formed in your body. But you have to take a caution. If you have skin concerns like skin allergies, or you have any rashes and all when you sit under the sunlight, then refrain yourself from direct exposure. Like you can expose your legs or hands based on, you know, your health status. And take supplements as per your doctor's advice if you are very, very low, because vitamin D is a very important micronutrient for various metabolic pathways in your body, especially your hormones and your immunity system. So if you are low on vitamin D, and if you're not able to sit under sunlight, or if you are not able to get a lot of nutrients from the food, take your supplements under the consultation of your doctor, correct it, and then maintain it. Maintain it through the food and sunlight. So that's how you will be able to get enough vitamin D.
Okay. Thank you very much, ma'am. Lalita, ma'am, over to you.
Yes, sir. Yes. Thank you very much. Ma'am, there is one last question which Subhi sir also, and I would also like to know, which oil is preferred, ma'am? Which oil?
So, ma'am, again, there are different school of thoughts on this. As per the research which has been, you know, been conducted in the recent 1 year at NIN, our National Institute of Nutrition, which I had also attended in January, most of the researchers said sunflower oil is the best oil for cooking purpose. And if you want to fry or saute something, so rice bran oil is the best oil. So I think a combination of these two is something which is advisable. So you can have like partially you can use sunflower oil and partially you can use rice bran oil in your cooking.
Wonderful, ma'am. Wonderful. Thank you so much. I think it has been a really enriching experience, both your session as well as our Naidu sir session. And and you know, I think I am quite inspired. Naidu sir, you'll find a difference in me.
yeah. Thank you very much, ma'am. Deepa, ma'am. Really profound session, and almost end to end.
Yes.
Maybe we can watch. All our children can watch in the Facebook whenever they have some doubts.
Anytime. Anytime. They can reach out anytime. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much. Thank you,
parents.
Audience.
Thank you, students.
And you have a wonderful evening, Sunday evening. And let's all get regenerated. From Monday, we'll start with our new diet plans and time schedules and exercise and so on. Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you, sir.
Thank you all.
Thank you all. Bye-bye.
Thank you.